That's a tragedy.
Yes, it is.
Y'all ain't been watching the news. They just celebrated that.
Yeah, anniversary.
And some of those people are still in the same frame of mind that they were in before the incident at the club.
Yeah.
I'm already seeing it. Y'all watch Yana. Some of y'all watch it. Y'all think instead of coming to hear me, y'all will watch Yana on TV and fix your life. I wish I had some right. I know y'all watch Yana. I watch it too sometimes. I just watch it just to see what she be saying.
Come on now.
You know she's a licensed and ordained minister, but you don't never hear her talk about Jesus.
Come on, man.
I wish I had some friends. You know, she might be new age. I don't know.
Yeah.
Y'all be listening to her because she be trying to fix your life.
Uh-huh.
And you know, and I'm telling you, it ain't right.
Yeah,
it ain't right, but she had those people on her show, and some of them are still in the same frame of mind, Lisa. They still... No, they still kicking it in the bobo.
Uh-oh.
You got a cat daddy up there, and the cat daddy's still talking about him and stuff. We gay now. So you had a couple of young men and young women. And it's kind of sad to see how lost people are, and yet they don't even realize that God is offering this gift.
Yeah.
He offered his only begotten
son.
He's offering himself
yes, sir.
To free us from the tragedy that's to come.
Wow.
Now, when we see these different terrorist acts and all that kind of stuff, guess what that just means? That is the tragedy to come.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
That's the destruction that's going to come.
Yes,
this time it's coming by fire. It's
yes,
going to be by flood.
Yes, sir.
It's going to be fire this time. And some of us feel it right now because if I didn't have the ailment here right now, it would be scorching.
Oh,
this
yeah.
Burning up.
Oh, yeah.
Everybody would be sitting here with fans, sweating. Big drops of sweat be coming off, y'all. Y'all be trying to come off some clothes, everything.
Yeah, it's hot.
Because it's hot in this building.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But it's going to be hot.
Yeah, yeah.
Look at your neighbor and say, hot. Hot. Yeah, it's getting ready to be hot.
Ready to
I ain't talking about summertime. It's
getting ready to be hot.
And so here, Luke gives us this picture. If I can use this for a subject matter, for a theme. God's love in action. He's still saying to you, you know, because love is an action word.
Amen.
So here Jesus himself, called the Son of God, he is the Son of God.
Amen.
Here he is saying, Father, forgive them, for they do not understand. Great God from God, after we spit in his face,
that's love.
After we plug, you know, plugs of meat, we ripped his body to pieces.
Yeah.
Isaiah saw the account before it even took place and said that when they put the crown of thorns around his head, it ripped the meat out of his face and he was unrecognizable. That's a terrible, I love your tan, by the way. That's a terrible thing. We got that kind of skin. We got Indian in us and we tan like that. Ripped, can you imagine, they ripped his face to pieces, whereas Isaiah said before it even happened, before the Immaculate Inception even took place, the Word becoming flesh, the incarnation, said he saw him and said, you couldn't recognize him.
My Lord.
Yet, the same one said, Father, forgive them. Right? God, after they put the spear in his side to make sure that he was dead.
That's right.
That's why they put the spirit aside, because all of this is prophecy now, y'all.
Come on now.
And all of the prophecy has been fulfilled. And this is why I preach with passion and I plead with you guys, get right with God, because we don't have time. We're actually out of time.
That's
right.
Huh? Amen.
Today is the day of salvation. Yeah. We're out of time.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Don't think that you have time.
That's right.
I'm sorry, I scared my baby. I'm sorry. Don't think that you have time to get yourself together when he's giving you all the time in the world. Can you imagine Deborah being preached to for 120 years? Just suppose God was letting us live to be 120. Now, there are some people that's living up to be 116 and all that stuff today. But still never, ever accepting the good news.
That's right, that's right.
Noah preached to those people for 120 years.
Yes, yes, yes.
Those people was living for 120 years, elder. And they rejected it to the end. And so when the doors were closed, guess what? They were more open no more. It said in the scriptures that God closed the doors himself and he sealed them. And it was just Noah, his wife, his three sons, and their wives. They people. Everybody else was destroyed.
My Lord.
And guess what? Don't y'all know that the sins of mankind has reached an all-time level beyond the sins that they were doing in the past?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, let me ask you this question. Do you still think you got time?
Nope.
Because you out of time.
Yes, sir.
Because the sins that are committed today are a lot worse.
Yeah,
now, sin is sin to God. But the sins that are being committed today, we got new gods now. The gods of technology, the gods of money, the gods of materialism, houses, cars, clothes, jewelry. People make gods of their children. That's why I tell y'all, be careful. Be careful how you step. Before an awesome, holy God, be careful how you step. Because we've run out of time. We don't have the time like it used to be. We used to think we got all the time in the world.
Amen.
Some of y'all probably still think you got all the time in the world. Stop by to tell you today that you don't. The devil has suggested to you that you have time. And he knows that his time is up. Don't you know that he's squirming right now? He don't even know what's going to happen right now because he don't know the hour or the time. Jesus left it clear to us. You won't know the hour or the time.
Come on now.
You won't know the hour or the time. But I'm coming back like a thief in the night.
Come on now.
And this time it's going to be with fire. And I'm thinking about the man that was in the story. It wasn't a parable, but the man that was in the story, Lazarus. Not Mary and Martha's brother, Lazarus.
Come on.
But this other Lazarus. But yet he felt the torment. He said if somebody could just reach down and put a drop of water, I'm being tormented down here. He was miserable. He was messed up. Can somebody just reach down and put a drop of water on my tongue? Just a drop. He could feel hell. All right. Now, see, some of y'all think y'all going to hell right now. That's not the reality. The reality of hell is something that we can't even think of or imagine, just like heaven. Heaven, when you know, we get the picture of heaven, streets of gold, crystal clear. You can't even see it. It's transparent. It's so beautiful and so awesome. Everything is so beautiful and so awesome, it's not even being able to be expressed properly in the scriptures. When it's expressed in the scriptures, we can't fathom what it really is like. But you know what? I kind of get an idea of what hell is. Because here's my idea. Hell is, watch this, and this is going to help y'all because I'm not going to give you any Greek or Hebrew to make myself sound a certain way. Here's what hell is. Hell is being separated from God.
That's it. That's it. That's
from
it.
All
that's
eternity.
It. That's hell. Right.
You don't have other opportunities. You don't have what we say when we say a second chance. God is a God of a second chance. You ain't going to have no second chance.
No.
You breathe your last.
That's it.
You close your eyes for the last time. You won't have no second chance. You won't have no more opportunities because if you didn't make it right with him before you said the last words out your mouth, I don't know why people be trying to talk to everybody when they're on their way out of here. I wish I had some praying people. All of y'all can be with me around the bed talking about, hey, Pastor, we love you. And y'all think I'm going to be talking back to you. I'm going to be talking to the Lord. Lord, forgive me.
Man.
Lord, bring me over here.
Yeah.
I ain't thinking about these people. I ain't even looking back this way. I'm going to be focused. I'm just saying, y'all. Don't be with me. Y'all say, to say the last words, like, y'all want to hear something like, I love you, whatever. You should have told him that while he was living.
Yes,
I
sir.
Wait for the
amen.
You don't wait to get on his deathbed and he's going to tell you, know, I miss you, big mom. I love you. Okay, you should have been saying that while she was living.
That's right.
She gave her flowers while she was living.
That's right. That's right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Don't be trying to talk to me. I'm on my way out of here. Focus. So listen.
All right.
God's love in action. Let me give you a little story first. The brother of a young man who was murdered finally faced the killer in court nearly a decade after the crime. His voice trembling, he said these words. He says, where my brother is today, he can probably forgive you. He says, but I can't. Mm. Understandably, victims of mistreatment and injustice find it difficult to forgive, even to say the words that can begin to heal the deep wound and erase the pain that remains in our hearts. To forgive is not our immediate natural response. And so I understand, and don't get me wrong when I'm talking and saying that I can forgive, and that's because now I'm accustomed to just doing what the Lord has called me to do. It is an act of obedience to forgive. And that's what Jesus did. Jesus died on the cross in obedience to ask the Father, forgive them, for they do not understand. And so if y'all don't understand that forgiving is possible, and even though it's a natural response, that first thing that you will do is kind of well up and kind of be hurt, and I understand that, and you go through these emotional changes, and you think about what could have been done, and what could have been said, and all that kind of stuff like that. But if somebody will tell you today, after you take a deep breath, inhale, exhale, and you thought about it for a little while, you need to make up your mind to forgive. I don't care how bad it is, because I'm going to tell you right now, you can't even enter into heaven carry and mess with you when you need to. I wish I had some great people. I would be messing that down to you. You cannot enter into heaven. The Bible clearly states that we are to forgive our brother. Come on. I hear some Bible scholars out there. And that just means that the time and the number that you should forgive is innumerable. That means that you ought to just always forgive. There's no type of limit or time on it. You just should forgive. Because it not only helps that person that hurt or harmed you, but it helps you to not be stagnated, to not be imprisoned within your own self. It helps you. It helps you to be healthy. Don't you know a lot of people are walking around sick today because they have not forgiven somebody? I wish I had some great people in here. They're not sick because they've got physical health issues. They're sick because mentally and emotionally they still holding on to a grudge. Oh my God, I felt the Holy Spirit in them. They hold on to it, and then after a while, by and by, they get nauseated. They wonder why they're feeling like they're about to throw up. Feeling sick. I wonder why the head hurts so bad. Lord, how do I be getting these migraines? Okay, the reason why it ain't no medicine helping you is because you holding on to something you ain't got no business holding on to. Give that mess to the Lord. And let him bring healing and deliverance. And then you can move forward. All right. Okay, y'all don't have to take my business. I ain't no medical doctor. You don't have to take my suggestions. I just know for myself personally, this is for my own personal use, John. I just know that if I forgive people, I don't have a problem. But sleeping at night.
That's right.
If I forgive you, I don't have a problem going to bed and going to sleep at night. Because you ain't going to keep me awake with your foolishness. I was going to say, I'm not losing 1 ounce of sleep over you. I'm going to be able to go to sleep with my head in the pillow. I ain't thinking about you. And I'm going to be asking God to help you all at the same time. He's still going to be pouring out blessings upon blessings. Because I'm not being selfish. Oh my God. See, unforgiveness will bring on selfishness.
Oh, yes.
Don't y'all know that? Yes, that unforgiveness will make you selfish.
Yes, sir.
Because all you're thinking about is yourself.
Yes, sir. You ain't thinking about,
well, you don't know what they did. Right. Well, God knows what they did.
That's right. He does.
And you need to let it go. As a result of not forgiving, families live alienated from each other because of long ago hurts. Long simmering feuds erupt into violence. You know, you got family fighting about family.
Yeah.
You know why our kids are killing one another? I told y'all this before. You know why we got black on black crimes? Because they're angry.
Yeah.
Our young millennials, our young people are angry. And he's angry for the right reasons. They've been neglected. They've been kicked aside. They've been rejected. They've been turned out. Yes. The parents don't care nothing about them. They let them do whatever they want to do. They let them raise themselves. They're taking care of their parents because they're alcoholics and drug addicts and stuff like that.
That's right.
You know, they're trying to maintain. They're trying to go to school. They're trying to be children. They're angry. So what they do is they become violent. They become violent because they've been neglected so bad. And so we run around here trying to figure out what's going on with them. That's what's going on with them. But think about what Jesus said on the cross. In his mission to rescue us, Jesus constantly interacted with people in need. This is God's love in action. We have to constantly interact with people we don't even want to be bothered with. Sandra, the Bible clearly states that you ought to love your enemies. Oh my God. Oh my God. That you ought to love your enemies no matter how despiteful. I said something there. Y'all was a real funny pastor. You don't know what you're talking about. If people just, they treated me so bad. Love your enemies. No matter how they mistreated you and misused you. That was Jesus. You know why he could say that? It's because one time we were his enemies.
Yes, sir. Yes,
sir. We were enemies with God. Okay, it's in Romans chapter 5. Yet while we was his enemies, he ran down behind us, Cheryl, and he ran down behind us. And he finally got his hands on us.
That's right.
Hallelujah. Yeah, while we was his enemy. He loved on us. He demonstrated his love by sending his only begotten Son. That said those famous words, Father, forgive them, for they do not understand. They can't get no better than that. Love your enemies. Love them. You got to love them. And I know y'all saying, wow, that's rough. But guess what? That's God's love in action. Yeah, and when you can do that, when you reach that level, you're a mature Christian.
Amen.
I wish I had some friends. You ain't no baby sucking on your thumb all the time, waiting for me to put a pacifier in your mouth. You're a mature Christian at that point. When you can, forgive somebody that has done some harm to you. Oh, yeah, it hurts. And naturally speaking, I get it. But guess what? After the wind blows, after the dust has settled, you need to think about it. Even if you can't even talk to them, write them a note. Clear it up. Get it off your chest. Get it off your heart. Write them a note. You did so-and-so to me, and I'm hurt, but I forgive you. Let them know. So you can be set free. All right, I'm getting ready to work through this, y'all. Watch this. In his mission to rescue us, Jesus constantly interacts with people in need. This is God's love in action. He had healed the sick. He had fed the hungry. He had taught the wandering. And these were some of the same people that laughed at him when he was on the cross. The same people that ridiculed him and mocked him before he got there. Did you see that coming? They punched him in his face. And they asked him like a psychic, did you see that? Could you predict the future and see me punching you in your face? That was sarcastic.
Yes, it was.
At its worst. Did you see that coming? He healed these people. He fed these people. He taught these people. And so we should interact with folk on an ongoing basis. Because guess what? Now he's given the rescue mission to us. I wish I had some friends. I know y'all don't want to hear that kind of stuff. Oh, Lord, you mean I got to rescue my enemy? Yes, because he rescued you. And so now he's giving you the rescue mission. Now you get to tell them the good news, or better yet, watch this. You get to show them by example.
Amen.
That's why, you have to be careful about what you say, to people. I was talking to somebody yesterday at this cookout, and this guy knew a whole bunch of people that I knew. And I said to myself, Lord, thank you for letting me shut my mouth with my tongue. I wish I had some friends. You know, you be talking about something like that. You don't think other people know those people. But they know those people, and you talking about them. Then they get back. And then they get back to you, and you keep wondering, well, you want this? How you know? They done went back and said, the pastor, he's talking about you like a dog. You gotta be careful, y'all. But we gotta interact. This was true throughout his earthly ministry. And now, even though he was innocent, he was humiliated, he was mocked, he was beaten. Amazingly, it continued even on the road to Calvary as Christ encountered even more needy souls. Simon of Cyrene took Jesus' cross in verse 26, but rather apparently took Christ as his own Savior in Mark chapter 15, verse 21. Took him as his Savior. So there was something there, more to it than they just seizing Simon of Cyrene. He came to know Jesus Christ in a personal way, carried his cross. And so it tells us something today, too, that we need to bear our cross. You need to pick up your own cross. Don't worry about what your wife's doing. Don't worry about what your husband is doing. Don't worry about what your kid is doing. You bear your cross and come to know the Savior in a personal way. You got to bear your own cross. In the darkness of that moment, no one could expect his parched lips to say these words because his mouth was dry. He says, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. In Luke 23:34. But they were the first words. Watch this. He spoke from the cross. This is God's love in action, y'all. He said, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. Imagine their impact on the people who heard them, these words. Jesus instructed the daughters of Jerusalem as they grieved for his coming death in verses 27 through 31. And he offered salvation to a thief dying on the cross next to him in verses 39 through 43. Jesus expressed neither anger nor hatred, but the most loving words a person could bestow on another person. Words of forgiveness. He said, Father, forgive them, for they do not understand. On today, I don't know if you understand or not, and I'm pretty sure you do. I'm pretty sure your minds are clear, regardless of what's going on in your life, in your circumstances, in your situation. But have you forgiven somebody that has really hurt you? Because right now, that's probably what's ruining your life. Is because you're holding on to something that you can't even handle. Don't you know that God wants you to give him all of that stuff so he can free you up, so that he can give you the freedom that you desire? You know, freedom is like having peace of mind. Amen. I wish I had some praying people in here. I'm talking about when you are not thinking about how am I going to pay the bills? What's going to happen next? I need a job. I need to finish school. I need a car to get to work. I need somewhere to live, a bigger place. Why would you worry about those things when your soul is at stake?
My Lord.
Your soul is at stake.
My Lord.
You should be concerned about where am I going when I leave from here? I just told you you're out of time. I'll wait for the amen to die back. I'm almost finished with this message. I just told you you're out of time. Time is not on our side. Tomorrow is not promised to us.
That's right.
And so you have to live it up. Today is a day of salvation.
Yeah,
today is a day you ought to be living it up.
Yeah.
You ought to be enjoying yourself. I don't care what's going on. I don't care if you ain't got no money in the bank. I don't care if you ain't got this or you don't have that. You ought to be living life. Great God from God to the fullest. Because it's going to come a time. Gonna come a time and you ain't gonna be able to live and see
no. You
ain't gonna be able to say nothing. That's why you need to make your peace with people now. You need to talk with folk and make your peace with them now. You don't know. We don't know the hour or the day. But first and foremost, I want y'all to be free in here on today. I'm talking about, he said, Father, forgive them, for they do not understand. And okay, I get that. But now that I understand, I need to do something. I need to put some love in action.
Right.
You know how we talk about we love one another?
Right.
I love you. Right. Well, instead of you just saying words, show me.
Show me.
Show me something.
That's right.
Huh? Because I'm going to show you something.
Yeah.
Huh? Because that's what we're supposed to be doing.
That's it.
Amen.
Love in action is showing people something. That word love is an adjective and it is a verb. And it means to do something. You just can't say you love somebody, but then you go and talk about them like a dog and gossip about them and slander their name. And they've been nothing but good to you. You can't do it. You're a hypocrite.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Come on now. That's what it is. Pastor, you getting hard. You stepping hard. That's how I step. Step rough. Because it's real. Because the world is coming to an end. It's the noise. And we're sitting around playing church instead of loving and forgiving and reconciling. Don't you know that that's what Jesus did when he came on his rescue mission? He was to show us the love of the Father. He asked the Father to forgive us, for we do not understand. Then he restored relationships that were broken. Am I right about it?
Yes.
So that's what he did. And that's all he wants us to do. We don't have to do a whole bunch of stuff, through hoops and all that kind of stuff like that. He didn't call us that. Jesus expressed neither anger nor hatred, but the most loving words came from his mouth. Forgiveness. His ultimate passion as he hung on the cross was his desire for lost, guilty people to find forgiveness in verse 34. That's God's love in action. In Jeremiah 31, I read those verses to you earlier. He says, I loved you from the past. I had this everlasting love for you, this loving kindness for you from the past. Because he did not want you to perish and die and go to hell. Don't you know that hell is the real estate that belongs to God? I wish I had some brains. Okay, if y'all don't believe me, this is why you need to read the Bible. Hell belongs to God.
Yes.
Hell is a place where only God can put you in. But the Bible clearly states to us that hell was not created for man. You need to read your Bible. It was created for the devil and his angels. Those who are fallen. Not man, it's never said anything about man being put in hell. But men go to hell because they make a choice to go to hell. God has given it only to God the Son. No, he didn't want none of us in his parish to have everlasting life. And so on the day he said, Father, forgive me, for they do not understand. You need to take those words and let them resonate in your spirit on the day. That's one of the best things that could have been said to me besides, well done, our good friend. Thank you, Jesus, the rest I have prepared for you. And I don't hear those words. I don't know about you on the day, but the doors of the church are open. If you don't know him in the pardon of your sins, come on, you can get it right now. Come on, get right with the Lord right now. Don't wait for tomorrow. Don't wait for the next day. And don't let Satan tell you right now. You know, Pastor Woolard, he was preaching, and he told y'all the truth, but you got time. It's one of his most arsenal weapons. Is that he'll tell you that
time,
and your time is running out, and you don't know when your time is up. But he uses that as a device. He uses that so that the more you stay away from God, the more he can get you away from God, the better off he has the chances of getting your soul. Your souls are at stake this morning. God's love in action has proved to you.